All right, I think it's time. We got to get going. It's the last day of Tech Ed. Everyone's tired. Hopefully you have somewhat of a sugar high now from that snack. Maybe just for a little while longer. Just hang with me. I need you here. We got a great session today. This one is on WebF 4.5, so hopefully we have a lot of WebF 4 users here already. Even if you haven't, don't worry. We'll take you through some of the basics before we kick into it. But what I wanted to start off with right from the beginning is play a little game of Guess Who. How many people have played the game Guess Who before? It's that, you know, weird tile one that you play as a kid and you have a picture of who your person is and you're trying to play against an opponent and guess who their specific person is by calling out specific traits like, does your person have a beard? And no, I don't have a beard, in fact. I got rid of the beard. And so we're going to play a game of Guess Who. So what I'd ask is, actually, can I have everyone stand up? Because you guys are probably getting really tired right now. I know. Can I have everyone stand up? You will be living tiles in my experiment. Living tiles. All right, everyone on your feet if you are able. We're going to play a game of Guess Who. And, of course, the first clue is, if you have a pulse, continue standing. If you have a pulse, you can check it right now. It's actually pretty easy to check. There's probably a number of different places you can check. If you have a pulse, continue standing. All right, this next one, I see everyone standing, so that's a good sign. Thank goodness. All right, the next one we have. If you have used workflow in the .NET framework before, that is workflow 3, 3.5, 4, 4.5, any of those, continue standing. All right, we're seeing some people sit down here, but I would say we got about 80% still here. All right, hang with me, guys. Here we go. Next one. If you have used WebF 4 or 4.5, please continue standing. Oh, we're losing some more. We got maybe half left. We got maybe half. You guys know what's coming, right? Have you used .NET 4.5? Have you used WebF 4.5? How many people do we have still standing? How many people? We've only got a couple. We've got a couple in the front here. All right, and the last one, of course, is if you happen to be Canadian as well. Are you Canadian? If you're Canadian, please continue standing. Hey, look at that. Hey, I'm the only one left. How about that? I am Canadian. Thank goodness. I was a little bit afraid, actually. If I did happen to have another Canadian here, I kind of hedged a little bit. You see the Superman sign here. I see a Canadian. I see your hand. Thank you. I put the Superman sign on there just in case, if I had to convince you that I happen to be Superman. You guys may not see it right now, but hang on one second. How about now? Yeah? Do you see it? All right. I'm going to put those back on because I'm blind without them. All right. My name is Dave Cliff. I'm a program manager on the Windows Workflow Foundation team. I've been there for at least a few years now. Jürgen's had to put up with me. And really enjoyed it. Workflow is a fantastic technology. That's exactly why you guys are here. What we're going to do today, we're going to talk through some of the Workflow 4.5 features that we have rolling into 4.5 using Visual Studio 2012. I'm going to take you through a lot of these features. We're going to see a lot of demos. It's going to be great. Hopefully that's what you're here to see. But before we do all of that, I do want to, of course, checkpoint first and go back to the beginning of why would we use Workflow at all? Why is it that this framework is interesting? What kind of apps should I apply it to? Because the fact is, it doesn't apply to everything. I could stand up here and lie to you and tell you that, but it doesn't apply to every app that you're going to write. But of course, it is useful for some particular subset of apps, and I want to make sure that you understand what those are. I'm happy to take Q&A throughout. I do really enjoy taking questions. The fact is, we do have a lot of material, obviously, and so if I'm finding that there's too many questions coming in or I'm talking too much, I'm just going to cut you off, okay? I'll probably make some motion like that, too, like get down and do a nice stance and just, you know, like a karate chop. But I'm going to have to cut off questions if that happens. Hopefully it won't. Hopefully we'll have a good, I want it to be at least a little bit interactive because I want to get a good feel for, you know, what kind of stuff is interesting to you guys. What have you built in the past? Where are you interested in learning more? All right, with that, let's continue. So why workflow? Well, really, I feel like there's three kind of core value props to why you would use workflow in any given .NET application. The first is around being able to customize business processes. And this is a screenshot that I've actually put up from one of our ISV partners who we've worked with a little bit in the past called Adorant. This is their expert product. And what this is effectively just a screenshot of their design experience. And it's very similar to the Visual Studio design experience in that it's actually just a rehosted rehosted version of our designer within their application. Excuse me. Now, what you'll see on the left is you actually see a number of different activities, and these activities are specific to the Adorant persona. So the particular user that's coming in and using these things, they are a business user. They're not really comfortable doing development per se, but what they are comfortable with is dragging and dropping things into a flowchart and actually building out a customization of their business process. So in this particular case, they are customizing the leave request. So, you know, how do I submit a request for leave, and what's that process look like in my particular company? So Adorant's the ISV, they don't actually build out workflows themselves. That's what their customers do. So they are kind of an ISV who effectively ships this software and allows you to customize your business process. And we have a number of other great examples of Microsoft products that do this as well. Think SharePoint, SharePoint workflow. What is the domain-specific language that I use for interacting with SharePoint? Well, I'm doing things like creating tasks and waiting for tasks to complete, and I'm updating list items, and I'm deleting list items. And that's the language that you want to use. And so, you know, when you're thinking about building your apps, if that's something that the kind of behavior that you want to give to maybe a particular set of non-developers, be it information workers, business analysts, IT pros, you can take the workflow design experience rehosted within your own app and go party on. The next point is around coordination of long-running work. And this is just the fact that workflow is great for kind of modeling these discontinuous processes, these continuation-based processes that maybe stop for some amount of time because they're waiting for human input, like wait for a task to be completed, for instance. So they kind of will wake up, they'll do a little bit of work, they have a bunch of business logic associated with them, but then they'll stop and they'll wait for a message to come in, or they'll wait for a timer to expire, any number of things. What workflow is great for is actually modeling these processes, and then effectively it'll do all of the coordination for you. So it does all of that work of maybe I'm calling web services in order to make this particular thing happen. So I can very easily use some call web service activities. I can customize those into my own DSL if I so choose. And then, again, I can model all those in my workflow. And the overall process defines kind of the long-running work that this entire process is over. So the last point is around transparency. And this is one that I think, in some ways, we have potentially underemphasized. Just in talking with some of our MVPs in the past. Transparency here, you may have heard this termed kind of declarative, or you may have heard it termed data-driven, metadata-driven processes, that kind of thing. This is the concept that your process itself is actually just kind of a blob of XML. It's a blob of XML that we can take within our runtime and run on your behalf. And the great thing about that is that you get this kind of these dynamic programs. You don't have to do recompilation of the entire program when someone changes the requirement. You give them a nice design surface that they can go change the process. They can click save. That publishes the XAML, the XML definition of that process that they just created, and you can go run that on their behalf. The nice thing is that this thing is, you know, because it's an XML wrap, it's a data-driven wrap, you can look very clearly at it in terms of a designer experience like this. This is a flowchart, obviously. And I can follow very easily what this process is doing. It's very transparent in terms of what it's doing. I don't have to spelunk through lines and lines of code in order to understand exactly what the process is doing. So transparency is great in that way. The other part is that within the workflow framework itself is this concept called tracking. And hopefully a lot of people are familiar with tracking already. And it's basically the data that's emitted from our runtime when a process is run by it. And that tracking data is very easily mappable back to the process. So you can very easily say, hey, this is exactly where I am in my process. I am getting the approvers list. Or maybe I'm waiting for an approval, and this particular instance happens to be in this state. It's waiting for X. So that's really what workflow is good at. It's good at modeling these sorts of processes. And this is what a lot of people use it for. The number of customers that we have that do things like customizable business processes where they're doing coordination of long-running work and they're leveraging the transparency, they're really nailing the sweet spot of Windows Workflow Foundation. So hopefully this lands. Hopefully this is, you know, this. If there's one thing that I can ask for you to walk away with, it's make sure you understand the value prop of workflow and why you would use it in your app, because it's so key to understand that and make sure that you're applying it in the right scenarios. All right, let's continue. We have kind of two veins of investments that our team, from a workflow perspective in Microsoft, have been making. One is around these WF 4.5 investments. And this is kind of all of the rich new features we've added based on customer feedback from .NET 4. The other vein is around our Windows Azure work. So we're doing a lot of work to make sure that workflows are easily runnable in Windows Azure, in web role, in worker role. And how many people happen to be at Jürgen Willis's talk on Windows building workflows with Windows Azure? So we got a few people. So if you didn't catch that and you are very interested in learning more, that's where Jürgen kind of went over checkpointing and talking about where, you know, some of the investments that we're making in this area, because this is one area that we're focusing very heavily on. So if you have a chance, go back in time, you know, pull a Marty McFly, 88 miles an hour, 1.21 gigawatts, go back in time and go listen to Jürgen's talk, or just listen to the recording afterwards, that's fine too. All right, let's get into it. Lap around WF 4.5, where have we been spending all of our time, and what kind of features have you as customers been asking us for? Because really, the one thing that I do want to drive home from this session, if there's one thing that you remember from this session, ignoring the last one thing that I mentioned, if there's one new thing that you'll remember from this session, it's the fact that WF 4.5 was driven from customer feedback. We shipped .NET 4. We talked to customers. We tried to understand, what are you having problems with? What are you missing? And that's exactly where we pulled this feature list from. So the first category of improvements that we made is around authoring improvements. And we made just a ton of improvements just to our Visual Studio Designer experience, making sure that that's much more easy to use, such that you know, it's nicely integrated with a number of different Visual Studio features that are there. The first one being, you know, supporting C# expressions in your workflows. This is one of those pain points that people just kind of scratch their heads after .NET 4. Why is everything VB expressions within the workflow? Well, it's a great question. We have C# expression support here now. We've also had a lot of feedback around workflow services and being able to author based on contracts first, and being able to take maybe a WSDL or take a WCF service contract, implement a workflow using that. So we've done a bunch of work there as well. I mentioned all the kind of designer improvements. There's a huge swath of designer improvements that I'll go take you through. And a lot of these are just around productivity improvements with workflow in particular. But also, there was a huge emphasis from our customers on, hey, I built this really large workflow, and now I can't really get around in it. Like, how do I find things? How do I, see my entire process? That kind of thing. So, kind of doing large workflow navigation was another area that we wanted to drill on and make some improvements. We added the ability to add annotations. This makes drives the transparency thing home even better, because now you can add comments to your workflow such that you can actually see what it's doing and document what it's doing. And then around state machine, we actually introduced this in .NET 4 platform update 1, but this is now kind of a rolled-in part of .NET 4.5 as well, so you don't have to do some separate installation of a platform update in order to make that happen. So I'm going to take you through some of these in demo form. The second area of investment that we made, jumping over hurdles in, was around versioning. So this was an area that a lot of customers were saying, hey, you know, you haven't really given me any help here with respect to how to implement versioning of my long-running processes. So we wanted to make sure that we really made this first class. We give you both the building blocks for building out a versioning story yourself, if you so choose, and on top of that, also give you some capabilities to version both workflow services as well as do kind of dynamic update of instances. So we're going to spend a bunch of time here just shortly. And then finally, the last area, we made some specific runtime enhancements around performance as well as supporting partial trust, being able to run your workflows in ASP.NET Medium Trust, and then also be able to extend the expression story such that everything doesn't have to be maybe VB expressions or C# expressions. If you want to, you know, plug in your own kind of expression story, we've actually done a bunch of work there as well. So I'm going to actually go through and demo a lot of these things. So this is the D's showing up. The D is not for my name, Dave. The D is for demo. So we're going to actually go through a bunch of these very shortly. Any immediate questions, concerns that I can address? Anything regarding business rules? So no, we haven't made any further investments with business rules. You can continue to use the WebF3 engine, the .NET rules engine, within your Workflow 4 apps. That's completely supported, works great, and not much more to say about that. All right, let's continue with a demo to the demo station. Okay, here we go. So I'm going to start off by showing you some of the kind of authoring improvements, some of the designer enhancements that we've spent a bunch of time with in Visual Studio 2012. So the first thing to point out here is what I've got in terms of a process here is a hiring request process. So someone, you can kind of, you know, if I kind of show you this workflow real quick, it's a flow chart. I've got some, you can kind of get some idea of what this process does. You know, it's got a start, it gets some manager approval, it does, you know, some switch depending on what the manager said, then maybe get some department manager approval, and potentially some CEO approval if necessary, and goes and updates systems. And you've got this workflow that, again, it kind of describes what the process is. And what I can do actually with some of the new features, I can actually pan around this. So I can actually do some panning here, which is kind of handy. You don't have to I don't have to work with the scroll bars. I can just kind of pan around my process. This is great for really large processes, obviously. And then I can also actually do some searching too. So if I want to search for, let's say, approval and see where approval is specifically shows up within my workflow, I can do that. So I can actually go, you know, and jump through, and this will actually jump me to particular parts in my workflow where approvals happen to show up. So it's actually used in the display name here, it's used in a property, and so on, all the way through the workflow. So those are kind of handy little things more than anything. But again, this describes my process, but it is a little bit hard to get out exactly what it's doing. The nice thing is, with the annotations feature that we added, now you can see you can actually add much more rich descriptions of exactly what these parts of the process are doing. So you can actually very easily add annotations. So I can, and then I can even dock them in. So I can go edit the annotation if I want to add some additional text. And then I can then go dock that back in so that actually shows up as part of that particular activity within the process. So that's really handy. Nice, allows you for nice commenting. It even shows up kind of down level. Once you've jumped down into the next level, you can still remember, oh, okay, what was I supposed to implement here? This is one of those things that's also really handy for mapping out your process before you've actually kind of implemented the whole thing. So that's what a lot of people, a lot of customers we've seen have tended to do is, you know, draw out kind of different shapes, mapping out your business process, and then go fill in the gaps when you actually have the implementation for it. So kind of some nice little features. I forgot to mention the outline view. There's actually an outline view as well. So if I go up to Quick Launch here, I can search for document outline. And what you'll see is we've actually got a different view of the workflow here in terms of a tree. So you can actually show kind of what is the tree of the workflow that's actually executing. So here, and I can actually navigate via this as well. So I can actually see, okay, I need to actually go update the update hiring request info activity. And you'll see it'll navigate me over to that. Or I can kind of jump down the hierarchy to kind of any of these points and go navigate very easily. So again, we're looking to try to give you a much, much simpler experience for navigating around large workflows. Yeah, quick question. How does this look in the dark view? That's a great question. I don't know. Let's check it out. So if I search for theme, I thought it was in theme. Oh, okay, it's a workflow designer theme. Here we go. I think the actual rest of the theme, the dark theme's up here. If I go to dark theme, so it actually darkens some of it, but it doesn't actually darken the Visual Studio designer surface right now. And that is actually something that we're working on for the next milestone. So hopefully by RTM we should have support for dark theme as well. All right. Cool. Great question. I'm going to put the theme back because it's going to totally throw me off for the rest of the demos that we do here. All right, let me continue. So we've actually got a bunch of additional functionality around kind of flowchart editor, Visual Studio editor as well. And this is mostly around kind of the ability to connect things up really easily with the workflow. So if I go and, let's say, drag and drop maybe an if into the middle here, what you'll see is that this actually connected up an if structure right in between these two activities. So I could probably show it in a better example further down. Let's see. There we go. So if I drag the if down here right onto the connector, you'll see it'll actually drop that right in between the connector and this activity, which is really nice. So you don't have to, you know, you kind of got that auto connect type functionality. And that also works kind of auto-connecting to additional activities that are already there. So you can actually go navigate around. That works with state machine as well. Really, really handy, great kind of designer improvement. The other one that may be near and dear to the heart of some people is really when you kind of get like an if activity here, and imagine I had just a single activity, you know, if, then, delay, and then I remember, oh darn, I actually need to put another activity kind of in sequence with that delay, and I forgot to do it. So what I can actually do now is I can drag and drop the activity right there, and it'll do an auto surround with sequence, so you don't have to actually have to do kind of the cut and paste mumbo jumbo that you had to do before. That's really handy. Yeah, quick question. Are all these features available and rehosted? A good number of them are. There's about, I think, five of the designer features that are. There's a couple that aren't, like C# expressions. We actually have a blog post that's out on workflow. Yeah. And actually, one of the things we've been working on is actually using the Roslyn CTP to try to fill that gap if possible. I don't know if you've played much with Roslyn, but we think there's definitely something that we can do there just in terms of a sample app to show how that's possible. Great question. All right, and the last thing I haven't even shown yet is the C# expression. So let me go. If I'm in a C# project here, I can actually, you know, as long as I'm working on kind of a new workflow. So if I'm working on a 4.0 workflow, you're going to get kind of the consistent experience. We didn't want to kind of break you in it or force you to upgrade to C# expressions by accident just because you happen to be in a .NET 4 project that was C# based. But you'll see now that I'm in C# targeting 4.5, I can actually add a workflow. And if I drop down, let's say, an assign activity, you can see I've got enter a C# expression here. So I'm actually using C# expressions within C# projects, VB expressions within VB projects. It's a wonderful world. We love it. All right. That's about it with respect to the kind of designer enhancements. That's just a kind of a rough overview of some of them, but let's keep going. All right, next area I want to take you through is, again, around the authoring space in particular, but it's using workflow services. So in using workflow services in .NET 4, a lot of people were a little bit miffed because they were like, hey, I love workflow services. I love using WCF, building out SOA, but I kind of have an existing contract that I want to implement my workflow with. How do I do that? And we kind of said, yeah, you can kind of do it. It's not really enforced, validated. It was a little bit hard. And so we thought, well, you know what? We can make this experience a whole lot easier. We can do a couple of things. So in .NET 4, your contract is kind of pulled out of your workflow definition. So on host time, we will actually walk your workflow, look for messaging activities, receive, send replies, transactive receive scopes, anything kind of to do with inbound messaging. And we'll actually create the WCF service contract, the service description for you, automatically behind the scenes. And then we'll expose WSDL for you automatically. So you don't have to worry about any of that. And that's great from a get-up-and-go experience perspective, but it does make it hard if you're looking to work with existing contracts. So what we want to do in WF 4.5, well, we made it such that you can very easily implement your existing service contracts, so your WCF service contracts, using the tools that we give you. And then you can very easily validate that, yes, my workflow does, in fact, implement this contract correctly. So let me go through what that experience looks like. All right. We're back into, here we go. This is Studio 2012. And what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to go create a new workflow service. I've actually got I'm actually going to do it from WSDL just for a little bit of a change because I haven't done that in the past. So what I've got here is a WSDL. And how many people just love WSDL? Love writing WSDL by hand? It's the best experience around. I'm seeing zero hands. And I know why that is, because WSDL is hard to deal with. But the fact is, you may be in an organization where maybe you've got a central architecture team that says, all right, we will define the contracts that you shall use, and you shall not define your own contract. And in which case, they hand you over, hey, here's a WSDL, here's a set of XSDs that you can go use, and go party on, implement your service. Maybe you're in a world like that, or maybe you're just used to, from a WCF service developer perspective, maybe you're used to coming in, typing out your WCF service contract, and you know that's one of the first things that you do whenever you start building a service, and then you just want to go implement that using workflow. That's totally fine. We want to support both those scenarios. I'll show you how to support it from WSDL here today. So here I've got a WSDL file. It's pretty simple. It's a vacation approval workflow here. And vacation approval has actually got its own custom XSD here for a particular vacation request. Hopefully you guys are really comfortable spelunking through XSDs and that kind of stuff. I love it. And by that, I mean I don't love it at all. So let's go implement this, all right? So it should be super simple. Well, in fact, the handy-dandy WCF team has actually gone off and built out an improvement to their SVC util tool. So they've actually got this thing called svcutil/service contract. So that's what I'm actually going to use on this WSDL file. Sorry, I need to put in the approval WSDL, and then we'll do /service contract. And what this will do, what you're probably used to using this for, is creating client code. Well, this will actually create service code instead. So it's going to create this vacationapproval.cs. So I'm going to go create a workflow service. I'm going to actually add a service library, WCF service library project, because that's good practice. We're going to go put our service contracts there. WCF service library, there we go. Call this one contracts. And then I'm just going to go add that new file that we just generated to this particular project. Here we go. It's under WSDL. This is the vacationapproval.cs that was generated for me. So what you'll see in this file is actually, it's just done a bunch of code gen. So it's code spitted a vacation class for me which has the particular properties that match my XSD. And then it's actually generated me the WCF service contract for vacation approval here. You can see I've got three operations: request approval, approve, and reject. And I'm just going to go implement a workflow using that. So we'll just go build that, and then I will add a reference to that project. Here we go. Solution. All right, there we go. So now that I've referenced that, what I should be able to do is within my workflow service project, I can right click, and I've got this icon called Import Service Contract. So if I click on that, what it's going to do is it actually is going to filter all of my references based on service contract types. So anything with a service contract attribute is going to show up here. You can see I've got a vacation approval contract there. So if I click OK, something's going to happen in the background. Something just happened, and it popped up a screen that said, the operation completed. You will see generated activities in the toolbox after your rebuild. So let me do that. Let me just do Control-Shift-B. And we will go use those within our workflow. So I'm going to jump back to my workflow service here. We'll plow that stuff, and we'll drop down, let's say, a flowchart. And what you can see in my toolbox here that's actually been generated is this thing called vacation approval. And these are actually configured receive and send reply activities that exactly map to the contract that I just that was generated for me. So I've got request approval here. I can drop this onto the canvas. And if I dive into that one, you can see, like I said, it's a receive and send reply. And it matches the contract. It takes an employee ID, takes a request, which is a vacation type, and happens to send a reply back. So that's great. I can start implementing that contract. Now, you're probably wondering, hey, you mentioned validation. How does the validation actually kick in? Well, if I go up to the root, the workflow service, what you'll see is on the root workflow service, we've actually got this new collection called implemented contracts. And this allows me to actually go say, hey, this workflow actually does go and implement the vacation approval class. So if I click OK now, we'll go open up my error window. Here we go, error list. You'll see that I'm going to start receiving errors that, hey, your workflow doesn't actually map to the contract that it's trying to implement. You can see I haven't yet implemented the approve or reject method, so I can go drag and drop those down. So I've got approve, I've got reject. There we go. And you can see all the errors went away. And if I happen to go into one of these and maybe I went in and accidentally changed the contract. Let's say I added the Is Chuck Norris flag. How many people have actually programmed and used the Is Chuck Norris flag before? No? It's really important for human processes like this, actually, to make sure that you have special cases for Chuck Norris. Because actually, when Chuck Norris takes vacation, do you know where he goes? He goes to the Bermuda Triangle. That's where Chuck Norris goes on vacation. I bet you didn't know that. Oh, I got another one, actually. Chuck Norris takes a week-long vacation every day. Think about that. That one was better. Yeah, I like that one. I should have done that one first. All right, the Is Chuck Norris flag. You can see as soon as I click OK, now I'm getting an error pop-up in my error list that says, hey, Is Chuck Norris is not part of the contract here. This is not going to work. And so what you're seeing is basically kind of real-time validation against this contract, making sure that I'm following the process, I'm actually implementing the contract that I intended to be. So that's great. I think that's about it. That's about it for workflow contract first. Let me jump back to slides and we will continue. Clicked the wrong one. There we go. All right, what are we going to talk about next? Well, we're going to spend a bunch of time talking about versioning, but I wanted to recap on kind of one of the basics with WF3 in particular, for those who are familiar. In WF3, you actually had the workflow definition as well as the instance state, and when you actually persisted that, it all went into the instance store. So all of that was stored in the persistence DB. And that was okay. That was kind of useful. I mean, if you happen to want to update that workflow definition, it was a little bit hard because you had to actually go update the workflow definition both kind of in the database as well as the instance state for that particular instance that you're going to update. And so in workflow 4, we thought, hey, from a kind of optimization perspective, you don't really need a persisted state or a persisted version of the definition for every instance that you're persisting. Really, you just need the instance state. And so that's one of the optimizations that we have in WF4 that is actually really nice, because it's a really big performance improvement when it comes to loading and saving instances, obviously, and certainly also decreases the size of your persistence store. Really, really handy. Now, the issue that a lot of customers in WF4 have run into is the fact that, hey, if I've got persisted instance state and I introduce kind of a V2 of my process, when I try to reload that instance, I don't know what version of this instance this actually corresponds to. And so in a lot of cases, that results in some really wacky exceptions, because you know, you get some weird exception message that, you know, sequence isn't the activity assigned or something like that. And this exception does vary depending on the extent of the changes to the workflow definition you made in V2. And so this was particularly problematic, we saw, with a number of customers who were trying to use persistence when they were doing development. So if you had enabled persistence and you were doing some development, I'm seeing some head nods here and there. People are like, oh my gosh, I can't believe that was so painful. I can't believe you did that to me. Well, the good thing is we've solved this problem. This is the WF4.5 solution to this, is to introduce this concept called workflow identity. And workflow identity is really kind of the core to all of these different versioning scenarios that we wanted to support. Really, what it does at its core is really just create that association between the instance and the definition. So it gives your instance state some way of knowing, you know, what version of the process am I again? What am I supposed to do? So it's actually represented very simply by a name and a version. So you can say, my workflow version 1.0, or my workflow version 2.0. This is persisted, so we've actually modified the schemas that we have for SQL Workflow Instance Store to incorporate this new piece of data, so we've kind of added to the schema. And we've made it such that you can then go query based on the version. So you can actually go look up and say, how many V2.0 instances do I have running? Or how many version 3 workflow instances do I have that were, you know, that were canceled or terminated? So you can actually go query on the instance state. And we actually allow you to effectively customize the behavior of the host. So in the case of workflow application, when you actually load an instance from disk, you can actually then look at the workflow identity and be able to make some decisions based on that. Like, hey, this is a V1 instance. Oh, with a V1 instance, I need to go look for the definition over here. So you can kind of implement nice side-by-side behavior. Or, you know, hey, I've got a V1 instance. Oh, I just loaded it, but V1 instances are no longer good. I need to actually update that to V2. So you can actually do dynamic update on that. And so this workflow identity concept is really a core concept that we've introduced that allows you to implement all of these different scenarios. And I'm going to show you how we've implemented some of these on top of the hosts that we provide out of the box. So with version 4.5 persistence, again, you've got this concept of workflow identity. So you've got an instance, you've got a workflow for 1.0, you've got an instance of the 1.0 workflow. Is that thunder, or is that just people moving chairs upstairs? I always kind of wondered. I always really wanted to use the phrase "bring the thunder" too with my presentations. So does that count? I don't know. It's kind of neat. Anyway, so with respect to the persistence store, now we've actually stored that information in the instance store. So you've got version 1.1 of an instance stored in there. And the great thing is it actually allows you to detect these kind of version mismatch scenarios. So if I've now introduced version 2.0 of this, and I try to load a 1.0 instance, I can get an exception, but it'll actually be a much more meaningful exception. It's, hey, these workflow identity versions don't match. And I can potentially even then, I can write some very much more interesting behavior, such as side-by-side versioning, such as dynamic update, on top of this feature. So let's look at side-by-side versioning scenario. The one scenario that I want to really harp on is this one. Imagine that you've got an existing business process, like in a mortgage approval, and it's going great. it runs, you know, runs successfully, it maps to all of the current standards, and that's great. And you've got a bunch of kind of in-flight instances. So you've got a client, and it's talking to the endpoint, and it's created a bunch of instances. Those instances are sitting there, and because they were started before a particular date, they're fine to continue running. However, the government comes and says, you need to implement something that, you know, will change the particular business process here. You're going to actually do verifying income as part of mortgage approval now. Seems like a pretty important thing to do, actually. But all of those changes will take place only after a particular date. So any mortgage application started after the new year will actually start to follow this new process. So the old ones are fine. They can continue to run to completion. But any new ones that we create once that rollover happens have to use that new version. And this is what we call side-by-side execution. And so we've actually implemented some behavior in Workflow Service Host to make side-by-side execution super simple. So let me show that right now. This is not particularly useful. All right, here we go. All right, here we are back in Visual Studio 2012. Hopefully you guys will be in love with this by the time that you leave. All right. This is my vacation approval scenario. I haven't implemented the Is Chuck Norris switch this time around, just for sanity's sake. But I've got a version of this process, and it's very simple. I receive a request, so request an approval, and then either I approve or decline it. So very simple process. And this particular workflow, if I just jump to web.config real quick. What you'll see is that this workflow actually implements persistence, so it uses SQL Workflow Instance Store to persist locally, and it uses the workflow idle behavior just to unload the instance as soon as it's idle. So very simply, what I'm going to do is I'm going to actually start this up, and we'll go create some instances of this process. So I'm going to use the WCF test client, super easy just to kind of test out your apps and have a very simple client experience. So we'll go and request approval for, let's say, employee ID 99. The purpose is tech ed. And there, I've got request submitted for employee number 99. Great. Now I can go request another approval, let's say, employee 50 for no reason. And we'll just create an instance for that. And you can see that if I jump down to the persistence store real quick, we'll flash that up. This is actually just the instances view. You'll see I've actually got two instances of this workflow that are running. And if I scroll all the way over to the side here, you'll see we've actually got some additional information here about the workflow identity. So it's a vacation approval workflow. It is the major minor build revision. The version is 1.0.0.0. And let me show you where all of that's defined. So now I've got kind of a couple of instances created here. I can actually go complete one of them just to prove that the workflow actually works. So I'll go approve it. There we go. Approve for nothing. There you go. And you'll see that this instance will go away. Great. So we've still got this one persisted instance, right? Employee number 99. He went to tech ed. Good job. All right. Let me take you through where workflow identity comes into play here. So if I stop that. Again, the instance is persisted, so when I come up and run next time, I should still see it. But if, again, I navigate to the workflow root and pull up my properties window, what you'll see is we've got this new property called definition identity. And it's of type workflow identity. It's got that vacation approval that I mentioned. It's got version 1.0 of the process defined. So every instance of this workflow service that's created is stamped with that workflow identity. And so what we can do now is we can actually define some behavior for how to create a new version. So let's imagine we want to actually create a new version of this process. And I want to, let's say, make this work for leave of absences. So I'm actually going to, in my data contract, since we support both kind of what's called loose versioning as well as strict versioning, with respect to the WCF semantics that are supported. So if you guys are familiar with WCF versioning, this will hopefully be very familiar to you already. But logically, hopefully you should be able to infer this, that in many cases, you should be able to add additional properties to your existing data contracts without breaking existing clients. So that's the key, is that in this versioning scenario, what you actually want is you want the client to not have to change in any way, right? You don't want the client to have to point at a new endpoint or anything like that. You want the client to still be pointing at the vacation approval endpoint that it knows about and be able to introduce new behavior such that new clients that come along should be able to consume that new behavior. So what we're going to do is I'm just going to uncomment this right now. This is I've added a new data member here. I said is required equals to false, so that makes sure that this is an optional new add-in that people can use such that the old behavior continues to work. And it takes a Boolean for whether or not this is a leave of absence. And since I've made a change there, I'm going to just build that. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to actually go create a new version of my vacation approval process, okay? That's actually going to take that new flag into account. So in order to do that, what I'm going to do is with the workflow service host, if I jump into this code right here, what you'll see is we've added this new thing on workflow service host called supported versions. And what this does is it allows you to add additional versions into the workflow service host on startup time to ensure that it captures all of the behavior of all of the different versions that it needs to process. So what I'm going to do is I want the primary one to be the new one, right? I want the primary one to be my version 2.0 such that any new instances of workflows are created using 2.0. But I want to make sure that the existing ones, the version 1.0 workflows, continue to run. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm not actually going to do this through code. I'm going to actually do this through a heuristic that we added for web host in particular. So if I go and add an existing ASP.NET folder, we'll add an app code folder. And then if I actually go and add a new folder under this called vacation approval process, what I can do is I can actually create a copy of my existing process, and I'll actually throw it into that folder. There we go. So this is my V1 process, right? My V1 process. I've just renamed it just for sanity's sake more than anything so I remember. And now what I can do is, in my vacation approval process, I can actually go and make my V2 changes. So let's go back into, let's see, properties on the root. We'll make sure we change the definition identity, right? We're going to make this version 2.0 of the workflow now. We are going to, for a leave of absence, let's require maybe two approvals. So what I'll do here is I'll actually, in my parallel here, I'll actually do two approvals instead of just one. So let me copy this. So I'm going to do an if. That's vacation.leaveofabsence. You see it show up here. That's my new property. So if it's a leave of absence, then I'm going to actually run an approval once, or sorry, an extra time effectively. And so let me just customize the output string here. So leave of absence, first approval granted. There we go. All right, so there we go. So I've implemented the changes that I needed there. Now I've got, again, those two approvals. So in one case, I'll go through the leave of absence and have an approval first. In other cases, I'll just have the single approval. Great, so let's run that and prove that it actually works. So now what I should be able to do is I should be able to go and request approvals. You see I've got this leave of absence flag, so I can actually click that to true. And I can go create new instances for different things. I can go create an instance, so I've got a request submitted for employee 56, and you'll see if I go approve that employee, I get this leave of absence first approval granted, so I've actually followed the new process that I've just defined. And then if I go approve that again, you'll see I've actually followed the rest of the process and completed that. But the cool thing is, I still have access to those old instances, right? So I want to be able to still, as a client, be able to update or interact with the old instances that are running. And because I've copied that file into the particular directory, that heuristic that I mentioned, I should be able to also interact with this employee 99 workflow that's still waiting. So let's see if we can do that. All right, there we go. And that is rejected. So again, that's that instance, that is a V1 instance that was loaded up into the workflow service host. We knew about the workflow definition that was associated with the V1. It was picked up just like any old instance into the same workflow service host and executed using its version. So you've got these two definitions executing side by side. Very cool. All right. And we continue. Believe it or not, we have more versioning features that we need to go over because there's more. There's other scenarios that we want to support. So this is an area that we call dynamic update. And dynamic update is really about how do I take existing instances, these V1 in-flight instances, and actually upgrade them to V2. So in that last example, I didn't upgrade them to V2. All I did was let them continue running as is using their definition. And these V2 ones, all the new instances were created based on V2. Now in this dynamic update case, you know, maybe I've got an existing set of instances, these V1 mortgage approval processes, and maybe the legislation says that no matter what, if that business process is started, I want you to make sure that you update it, and if it hasn't reached the step that has been updated, then make sure that you update that instance to the new process. The other scenario that is really common that we've seen is, hey, maybe you've got a long-running workflow instance, and it gets to a certain point, and you realize, oh no, there's a bug fix in an update that I made. How do I fix this? Well, you can actually use dynamic update for that case as well. So you can actually go update that to a new version that you go introduce that doesn't have the bug fix. So let me walk through exactly what that looks like. So in terms of the dynamic update experience, there's a couple of key parts to it. The first part is being able to actually create that kind of diff map between a version 1 workflow and a version 2 workflow. So I'm going to create this update map, which will tell my infrastructure, here's how to update an instance from V1 to V2. So I'm going to go create that update map first. And we've got a bunch of APIs that help you out here. Then you're going to actually go apply that update map. And again, we've got a bunch of APIs here to also do it. So this may be a handoff process in your particular organization. So it may be that the developer is going to come in and going to introduce this new version. It's going to create the update map. And then he's going to hand it off to, let's say, your DB admin, who's actually going to go, or your IT pro, who's going to actually go run these updates on this particular infrastructure. So you're going to take the V1 instances. You're going to apply the update map. And then you're going to get a V2 instance out of it that will run based on the new process. So let's take a look at what that looks like. All right. I see everyone kind of draining. Sugar high is worn off. Everyone still with me? Does everyone need to stand up again? Do I need to have you guys stand up again? I will do it. All right. I think you're with me now. Thank goodness. All right, here we go. We're in Visual Studio 2012 again. How many more times do I have to say that? All right, I'm gonna open up some dynamic update projects here. Here we go. So what we've got here is we've got a simple mortgage approval process. We've got a simple mortgage approval app. And if I launch it real quick, the workflow is very simple. It's just going to wait for some customer loan info. It's going to request an appraisal, and then it's going to wait for the appraisal value to come back. And so this is really just kind of your typical long-running workflow. It's waiting for input in a couple of places. And then this last step here, your verify loan can be sold. That's really the key one. That's really what's going to determine whether or not somebody is going to get approved for a loan or not. And if I show you the implementation of this activity, you'll see that all it's doing is evaluating whether or not your assets plus your gross income is greater than $1. I hope that's the case. You wouldn't be here otherwise because you wouldn't be working for that company. So hopefully your assets plus gross income greater than one. So that's really all we're checking right now because really, I mean, we give loans to everybody. It's no problem. You want a loan, you got a loan. And so that's really what this process is all about. It's showing just, hey, we've got this really kind of basic process that does not much validation. Okay, so we're going to run this, and I'll show you the UI real quick. So what I can actually do is I can go create new loan requests. You can see Chuck Norris already came down here, actually. He just recently bought the Bermuda Triangle. Huh, that's interesting. I'm going to create a new loan request. We'll fill it with some random data. We'll create a couple of instances of this. And I can go actually complete some of them. And a lot of this is pretty, you know, in terms of the data, it's garbage data. I mean, really, you know, with a gross income of $101, you're trying to buy a property that's $246,000. Good luck with that. But of course, in this day and age, no problem. So even if that property is worth, let's say, $250,000, no problem. Loan can be sold. We love it. All right, so I've got a couple of instances here that are alive. They're V1 instances. They're waiting for appraisals to be done. And what I can do is if, you know, say now I need to go update the process, what I can do is I'm going to actually launch this thing called an update map creator. So this is a little tool that we've created that we will ship as a sample effectively for you to use. But effectively what it does is it helps you kind of create that update map. What the experience that we provide out of the box is a number of APIs that help you to do this so that you could create an experience like this. But you're certainly welcome to use this tool if you so choose. So I'm going to go open that workflow definition. And what you'll see here is I am now going and creating an update map. So what it's going to do now is any change that I make to this workflow will effectively be kind of recorded as, hey, you did this, and then this was deleted, and this was added. And you'll see that as we go through the process. So first thing I'm going to do is actually update the workflow identity and say, I'm actually creating version 2.0 here. The next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to get rid of this useless verify loan can be sold activity. And we're going to replace it with a verify income and assets. So this is a new activity. You can see that this particular tool happens to be tracking the changes that I'm making as we're going through it. And I'll just make sure to populate that data here from the workflow variables. There we go. And now if I go and say create, what that's going to actually do is going to create me the actual this particular map artifact that can be used. So I'll call it loan approval 2, and we'll click save. All right, so I've gone and actually created my update map for my particular V2 of my definition now. Now the other thing I want to call out here is actually these kind of yellow circles that you can see, and you can see they're actually located on a couple of these waiting activities. And the thing that's really important here is just the fact that dynamic update is obviously really useful. It can be used to update workflows from one definition to another. But the key is that there are some restrictions in terms of your process. So imagine that your workflow is waiting for an appraisal value. And then all of a sudden you decide that, hey, V2 of my process actually doesn't have that step anymore. So I'm going to actually go delete it. And the reason that's relevant is that you've got a bunch of instances that are blocked on a bookmark that's actually waiting for that particular resumption. And so what you'll find, and what we'll actually just show next, is that you won't be able to apply an update map to those instances because those instances are actually just stuck at that particular bookmark state. So let me show you what that looks like here. So I'm going to close this one. We'll go to the next step, which is the applying the update map. And if we open up this one here we go. I'm going to apply the update map. You can see that I've actually got a couple of instances that exist already on V1. And if I go open changes here, I can go open that map that I created in that last step. And you'll see this map is targeting version 2.0. And what I've got here in this particular example in this particular little demo app, is this thing called validate changes. And if I run validate changes, it'll basically, what it does is it actually has, we have an API that will allow you to kind of run a simulation. So it won't actually update the instance in the persistence DB, but it'll actually run a simulation over that and tell you whether or not the changes that you've made in the update map will actually be successfully applied to the instance or not. And so this is really useful if you, you know, for your IT pro who wants to go run this and, hey, they're going to come back to you and say, hey, there's, you know, there's, say, five instances that can't be updated based on this. What do you want to do about those? In some cases, those may be instances that you can terminate and that need to start the process over again because the change that you're making is breaking for those instances. But it gives you an API at least to be able to do that. So with I've done the simulation here. I'm going to actually go ahead and apply those changes. So the update map has been applied successfully. And now what you'll see is that these workflow instances that are here, if I go refresh instances, they've actually now been updated to version 2.0. So these instances are now updated to the latest definition. They are waiting on a bookmark, and that bookmark will soon be resumed once we run the program here. So here we go. We're going to do one last run here. And we'll see that these instances are now following, that were stuck in V1, are now following V2 of the process. So this V2 obviously is considerably more stringent. So for this particular example, I'll submit an appraisal. And what you'll see is that I actually get rejected because my income and assets are not sufficient for the requested loan. So you see my income and assets were pretty low for this one. So that's dynamic update. That's about it. Let's jump back to slides, and we will close things out, and we got some time for Q&A at the end. Ooh, forward. Here we go. So from a summary perspective, these are some of the things that we went over today. We went over kind of new features for large workflow navigation. We went over improvements for designer productivity and making you more productive in the workflow designer. We talked about contract first authoring. And then we did a huge deep dive on some of the versioning features that we've introduced in .NET 4.5. But the thing, again, walking away from this session, you want to walk away with the fact that WF 4.5, going after top customer pain points with the workflow with the Workflow 4 framework. If there are ones on here that you've hit in particular that weren't addressed, I would love to hear them. By all means, come find me, or let's cover that via questions if you think there's something that I maybe missed. The other thing that I want to point out is, again, just going back to the value prop of workflow. Workflow is really a great platform for building customizable business processes where you're maybe pushing that experience to a non-developer, allowing them to dynamically create programs themselves such that you, a developer, don't have to get involved. Makes your job that much easier. They're great for coordinating long-running work, and they're awesome for from a transparency perspective, making sure that you can very easily see your program. So with that, that's about it. I don't have any other Superman jokes that I can make or anything else related to Chuck Norris, unfortunately, but I'm sure if we talk for long enough, I'll come up with something. So any questions before I kind of pop up the rest of the slides? There's some great resources here. Again, go listen to Jürgen Willis's talk on building workflows with Windows Azure, see some of the future stuff that we've been working on, and some great resources online for samples, a lot of the code that I showed. WF 4.5 samples, we got a bunch of them available already, code.msdn.com. Search for WF 4.5, and continue to give us feedback, honestly, because, I mean, hopefully this is been encouraging more than anything to show you that, yes, we actually do listen. We care very deeply about what you guys are building, what you're having a hard time dealing with, and how we can help. That's about it. Any other questions? Questions? Yeah, question at the back. Can I actually get you to, can we mic it up? That'd be great. Otherwise, I can repeat, I guess. But you guys are probably really tired of hearing from me by now.
Hello. I have a question about AppFabric. Will it be supported in AppFabric hosting?
In AppFabric?
Yeah. Yep. This
great
versioning
question.
Support.
So Windows Server AppFabric will be supported on Windows Server 2012. It's not today. With respect to these features in particular, we don't have any current plans to do any kind of integration into them from an IT pro experience perspective. But it is something that certainly if we get enough feedback from customers, we'll certainly push up our priority list. So for sure. Yeah. Oh yeah, but I should say, but certainly Windows Server App Fabric will run on top of .NET 4.5, so I should have caveated that, yeah. How does it interface with what, sorry, actually? So customizing your process, you can pretty much tailor the design experience to whatever user you want. So it's really on you to, in terms of the design experience, to take it, tailor it towards them, use your own domain-specific language that they're comfortable with using. And that's something that's entirely in your power in terms of the tool that you want to give them. Can it be used within a web app? That's a great question. So what we provide out of the box in terms of our workflow designer cannot today be used within a web app. That's actually one of the top asks that we've had on top of WF, on top of the asks that we've already addressed in terms of WF 4.5, is how can I get this working within a web authoring environment? And so that's I'm confident that that will be one of the first ones that we address in kind of our vNext planning. Yeah, great question. Great. Well, I hear it's raining. I don't know if you guys heard that, but so hopefully we get on some rides tonight. But if not, hopefully this was useful for you. And by all means, I encourage you to reach out to me. Come up and talk to me. I would love to hear from you. Thanks very much.